So they were singing about Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Our scripture reading this morning goes back to Matthew 21, verses 12 through 17, that recalls right after the time when Jesus came into Jerusalem. Now, the passage that we're studying, or that are in the series, in the study about Jesus' final days, is actually looking at this a larger portion of Matthew than what I'm going to read. So at the beginning of chapter 21 is Palm Sunday, where Jesus entered Jerusalem. This whole series about the last days of Jesus, we're building up to the culmination of Jesus' death and resurrection. And a major thing that happens is Jesus rides into Jerusalem, and just what we've been singing about. But we're actually going to observe also Palm Sunday, you know, so coming up a week before Easter. And so while that's part of what has just happened, if you're familiar with that part of the story, Jesus is ridden into Jerusalem. People are waving the palm branches and laying their coats on the ground before him, like rolling out the red carpet and singing, Hosanna, Lord, save us. Then I want to pick up now at chapter 12, where Jesus, now he goes into the temple. Again, remember, in Jerusalem, there was one temple for all the world, for all of Judaism. There was only one place where you could go and make your sacrifices and offer to God an offering, and that was in the temple in Jerusalem. And so, obviously, it's a very major part in the life of Jewish folks, but also in Jesus. So in Jesus' day, the temple was there on the mountain, and this is what happened. Chapter 21, beginning at verse 12. Then Jesus entered the temple and drove out all who were selling and buying in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And he said to them, it is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers. The blind and the lame came to Jesus in the temple, and he cured them. But when the chief priests and the scribes saw the amazing things that he did and heard the children crying out in the temple, Hosanna to the Son of David, they became angry. And they said to him, do you hear what they are saying? Jesus said to them, yes. Have you never read? Out of the mouths of infants and nursing babies, you have prepared praise for yourself. Then Jesus left them, went out of the city to Bethany, and spent the night there. Well, this is the word of God for the people of God. Well, you might say this sermon is like probably 35 years in the making. Because about 35 years ago, I was in college, and I up at UNI in Cedar Falls, and I started to listen to country music on KOEL in Olwine. I hadn't really listened to country music before, but at first I kind of listened to it, and I thought it was sort of funny, and a few things kind of caught me. And one of them was a song by George Jones and Tammy Wynette called Two Story House. Anybody know that song? I mean, it's an old-time country twangy kind of song. I mean, it's funny, but, I tell you what. You want to hear it? Now, listen to the words. Listen, it's about a couple that always wanted to have this big house. That's what they dreamed about, buying and living in a two-story house. Okay, see if you can't hear the words and pay attention.
Thank you.
lives. We always wanted a big two-story house. We worked and worked until we finally got there. We moved in. Now we live in a big two-story house. And what was it? How sad it is. I've got my story. He's got his too. We've got this big two-story house. We somehow left love out. Now again, it was a twangy old country song. I would kind of laugh and listen to it, but then realize, I think there's a message there. In fact, the scriptures that we're going to read, that we've just heard about, is that the disciples and other people are outside, you might say, this big temple, this big structure, this big two-story house, and yet, something's been left out. That's what we want to dive into today. So if you would you pray with me? Loving God, we thank you for the blessings, the joy that you've given to us, all the things that we've received, and yet we are aware that we're also in danger of leaving something out, of leaving you out, and holding too tightly to the structures around us. We pray now that we would be open to your spirit, your presence, your love, and that the words of my mouth, the thoughts that we would all share would be acceptable in your sight as we seek your word for us today. Pray this now in Jesus' name. Amen. We're in this series now during Lent about the last days of Jesus. And we're following Jesus' path, and we know that a number of weeks ago we remember how Jesus was with his disciples and told them, you know, who do people say that I am? And Peter said, you're the Christ, you're the Son of the living God. Jesus said, you're getting it. Now here's what that means. We've got to go to Jerusalem. And the Son of Man will be rejected and put to death, and on the third day rise. And Peter was like, no, that's not right. Jesus, you have it all wrong. Don't let this ever happen to you. And Jesus said, no, get behind me, Satan. This is what we have to do. And so we've been reading how then Jesus, again, he's starting to bring the disciples along. He takes James, Peter, John up on the mountain. And there Jesus is somehow transfigured before them. Talk about who was there last week. They're on the mountain. There appeared Moses and Elijah. We talked last week about how Moses represented the law. Moses brought the Ten Commandments, the law, and how Elijah represented the prophets, the people, the men who spoke for God. So they were there with Jesus, and again, we don't know what happened on that mountain, but it was an experience of which when Matthew and the others record it, and the James, Peter, and John remembered it. They were clear that Jesus was doing something, that God was present. They heard God's voice. This is my Son, the Beloved. You should listen to him. And somehow, they're significant that Moses and Elijah were there with him. And part of my interpretation has been, as I understand it, Moses represents the law, Elijah the prophets, and Jesus is tying it all together. Now, to think about the importance of the law is structure. The law preserves what has been. It sets up the rules that people live by so that we can live together. There's nothing wrong with the law. We need laws. There's nothing wrong with structure. We need structures. But Elijah was also there, a prophet, someone who said, "Thus saith the Lord." That's a relationship not based on a written code somewhere, but it's on a vision, it's an actual presence. A relationship of God with us in this moment, in this time. And it seems like all of our history and humanity is kind of trying to balance both of those, the law and the prophets. The law and relationships. You might say the law, which holds it, but also love. Stability, formal things that preserve the past, but also adaptation and change and adapting to that which is new. We have to have both of it. We can get out of line when we have one without the other. So the scripture reading today, again, takes place where Jesus now is coming into Jerusalem. And again, it's the Palm Sunday setting, so it's the last week of his life, part of the last days of Jesus. The video that our small groups will be watching actually has the introduction where they're standing on Bethany, which is like a hill overlooking Jerusalem. You can see the Temple Mount. I mean, you know the temple is no longer there. It was destroyed about 70 AD. It's never been rebuilt, and now there's an Islamic mosque that's there instead. But you can look over that today, Bethany, so it's kind of like just over a valley. It's not like a long distance, but it's just a little ways away. And Jesus has traveled into Jerusalem. He's remembered the scriptures that, you know, the king would be coming humbly and riding on a donkey. The people are all excited. They're singing, "Hosanna, Lord, save us," and waving palm branches and laying their cloaks and their coats on the ground, up, like making way for the king. But we're kind of aware that they probably had an idea of a king like any other king. Somebody who will rule and mobilize us and throw out the Romans, who are like these foreign occupiers and a hostile power. And that our king, our Messiah, would come and set things straight, and we'll be a powerful nation again, like we were in the good old days when David was here. So the people were cheering and yelling as they're coming in. And then it says, with the part I read today, then Jesus went to the temple there, and some of the scribes and the Pharisees, kind of the experts, the leaders of the day, they heard what these people were saying, and they said to Jesus, "Wait a second, what are you, are you hearing what they're saying? They're claiming all this stuff, and Jesus, what do you think about that?" He said, "Yeah, I hear it. Haven't you ever heard it's out of the mouths of babes and infants that truth can be spoken?" Reminds me, we had a lock-in a week ago with the fourth and fifth graders. There's something about kids, they don't have the filters yet. They'll just tell you what they think. The boys, they were going to stay up all night, you know. I was with the boys, and my wife Linda was with the girls, and so we're going to watch movies all night long. Okay, sure. So until about 2, they're all out, you know. And so I went to sleep about 2 o'clock, but the parents are coming at 7 the next morning. So 6:30, I'm waking them up, and come on, guys, let's get up and clean things up, and we got ready. Your parents are going to be there. And one of the students says, "Pastor Tom, you're acting weird." Which I was, but I mean, you would too. You're up till 2 and then up at 6 again. But kids just say what they think. And so the unfiltered joys and the shouts, people shouting, "Lord, save us. Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Now, part of what I need to go back and also say, when Jesus first came in, again, that temple, it was all about the temple, the structure, the law, the rules, the sacrifices. And so part of what would happen to be forgiven their sins, part of the practice was people had to come and bring animals to make a sacrifice. But if they're traveling a certain distance, they couldn't really bring the animals with them, so they would buy them there on the spot in the temple courtyard. And so there was a whole business that was set up. So people that were bringing in animals to be sold, and there was also regulation, you had to use the local money, the local currency. So if people came from other regions, other parts of the world, they had their local money, but they had to exchange it for the local money so that they could then buy the sacrifices that they could make in the temple to have their sins forgiven in their relationship with God. And again, it had become a big business. And so the people that were selling things or selling sacrifices, they're making money. They're taking advantage of these religious pilgrims. The money changers, they're kind of, you know, some for you, some for me, they didn't have calculators or ways to check things. People were taking advantage of people that were trying to express their faith. And when Jesus came in and saw that, this is one of those, you know, the picture on the front of your bulletins, one of those instances where it doesn't seem to fit Jesus' character. He confronted them, and he must have been so upset, "You've got it all wrong." And he overturned the tables where the money changers were doing their business. And he made a whip out of the cords and kind of drove out the animals and drove out the people that were selling and making a profit. I can just imagine Jesus just so upset and frustrated, says, "Oh, you don't get it. This house should be a house of prayer. This structure should be a place where God is worshipped and we connect with God, but you've left something out. You've made it a den of thieves, a den of robbers. You've taken this beautiful structure and changed it into something that it's not supposed to be." Now, a little bit later in time, later in the week, Jesus will be back on the Temple Mount, and the disciples will be with him, and a woman puts in 2 coins, you know, the widow's mite story, and the disciples say, "Oh, isn't this a beautiful temple? Look how wonderful it is." Jesus said, look, fellas, there's coming a time when not one stone will be left upon another. I mean, this temple, this building, this structure is not going to last. It's not the point of the relationship. Sure, it's good. There's some good things that can happen. But number one, you've turned it into what it's not supposed to be. And number two, it's a structure that is not going to be here before you know it. So there's really something else that they need to build their lives on. Now, as it goes on, then it says he goes to Bethany, which again is on this mountain, on the Mount of Olives, right overlooking Jerusalem. And he spends the night there. And the next part of the story, that again, I didn't read it, but you can go back and take a look at it in this Bible study we'll be looking at. They come back and Jesus sees a fig tree, and there's no fruit on it. And one of the other Gospels says there's no fruit because it's not the season. But he says there's no fruit on it, and Jesus curses this fig tree and says, may no fruit ever come from you again. And it's like the tree withers and dies right there. It's kind of a miracle story, and the disciples are amazed. Well, what was that all about? And Jesus, and Matthew records it, and you're trying to figure out what's the meaning behind it. You know, part of it seems like if you dry up and you don't bear fruit, that's not good. And so here's a fig tree, and again, there's the story of what happened, but how do we define meaning in it? You know, some people may say, well, that's because Israel had rejected Jesus, and so that's, you know, meant to be kind of symbolize that. But you know what? I think it's all of us. The whole point of the story isn't about what the Israelite leaders did in that day. The story is about what people did during that day. And the meaning is, you know what, I'm a people too. And I'm just as capable of doing the same thing. And so are you. So there's the danger of if you dry up and you're not producing fruit, that's not good. You'll wither and die. And yet Jesus would also say, whatever you ask for in prayer with faith, you will receive. Now, part of what I think is happening, I want to interpret for you, we need both structure. There's nothing wrong with a temple. There's nothing wrong with a building. There's nothing wrong with a house. There's nothing wrong with the law. We need that. We need some of that. It's structure that provides security and continuity and safety. I mean, it's a certain amount of structure like a house that lets you go to sleep at night, knowing that it'll be there when you get up in the morning. And you can kind of let your guard down and relax because there's something that's consistent, it's conserved. It will be there, and you can relax, and then you'll come back. But at the same time, if it's all about the structure, and if it's only the structure, just like in the song, there's the danger. You can have this big two-story house, but how sad. There's no love inside. And so the prophets, the living relationship, you know, Jesus would say, you know, there's all the laws, but all you got to do is love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. That means you can't live simply by the law or the rules or the structure. You've also got to live by what's in the best interest of the person next to me. And how can I serve them and love them and go above and beyond? Give of myself for their well-being. And it's in doing that that we truly receive life to its fullest. So when Peter remembers this, and again, Peter is told by Jesus, you're a rock earlier, I will build my church upon you. And the confession that he's made. And when 1 Peter, the passage that Reese read for us, you know, Peter uses that image about, you know, we're a living temple. That the temple isn't the structure of a building, it's the structure of people who are in a relationship with God and with one another. And so Peter would say, come to a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And, like living stones, be yourselves built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. He goes on to say, you know, God was laying a cornerstone, which is Jesus, but many people have rejected and turned away and not built their life upon the good news of Jesus. And I don't want to say that in a judgmental way. I want to say it in a reflective way, because I've done it too. There's plenty of times when I've built on foundation other than God's love for me and Jesus. And so the challenge continually is, how do we have enough structure that provides where we need to go, enough law so we know how to live together, but also enough freedom and flexibility that we can adapt to the relationships, the world, the things where we're going ahead. I think that's where, you know, we are as a church. The church, our United Methodist denomination, and I think honestly our nation, is struggled between conservatives and progressives. Conservatives conserve. The whole point is to preserve what's there, to keep what it was previously. And there's nothing wrong with that. Progressives are to progress, to make change, to move into the new world, and there's nothing wrong with that. In fact, my belief is that we need both. We have to have some conservation of what we've had, some structure, some laws, some safety, security, so that we feel safe. But if we're in the house and it never changes, it becomes a prison. It separates us from other people. We need enough structure, but then enough doors and windows that we can go outside and adventure out into this world and be with other people who maybe see things differently, and maybe we could do things differently too. I mean, as a district superintendent, I saw it again and again in local churches, where local churches would be so focused on the building. I mean, look at this building. Isn't this wonderful? It's a beautiful place, a sanctuary. But I tell you, there's coming a day when one stone won't be left upon another. In other words, it's just a building. It's going to go. What's important is what's inside of it. We need it. But if it becomes the focus, it's just like that two-story house. It no longer serves its purpose, which is providing a place for relationships to happen, for us to connect with God and with one another. That's why we have the building to begin with. And in some ways, on our denominational level, the structures that we've had as a general conference in our book of discipline, I mean, we need that. It's a good, it's part of who we've been. But if that's all we have, then we'll be caught in the past and never being able to venture into the future. And if we give, so what's our options? Well, you know, let's burn down the house, or then not have any structure. Well, then there's no safety. Or let's just leave this house, we'll go to another one. Well, you're going to have the same situation there. I mean, I don't know how it's going to turn out with our denomination. But at the general conference level, I mean, it's mostly structure. That's all that it can be. I think it's really in the local church where you can have the balance between the structure, the law, and the relationship, and the love that you have in people that you share your home with. That can really only happen here. That's why we can do here what they can't do at general conference. Why, in a local congregation, my prayer is that we can be a people that are conservative and progressive, that we can listen to each other and actually realize we need each other to keep ourselves from getting too far off the track. And somehow to find that balance then between having a firm conviction about what we believe, but also the reality that I might be wrong, and you might have something to offer to me as well. And somehow through it all, we can live together in the house of the Lord, which is not a house, a building. It's a relationship. It's a community. It's a family. It's a nation. It's a world where people learn to live with one another. I mean, John Wesley knew that this was, I mean, this is an age-old problem. It'll always be the case. It'll always be a struggle. I'm sure we'll be struggling with how to balance the structure with the freedom and flexibility. John Wesley even wrote about it early on. He said, I am not afraid that the people called Methodists should ever cease to exist in Europe or America. But I am afraid lest they should only exist as a dead sect, having the form of religion without the power. And this undoubtedly will be the case unless they hold fast to both the doctrine, spirit, and discipline with which they first set out. John Wesley knew there's always the danger of becoming the whitewashed tombs that Jesus called the Pharisees, of having an outward, you know, structure form that was so wonderful, but leaving something out, forgetting about the relationships with God and with others, which is why we have the structure. Okay, so here's our challenge. In our life together as the Asbury United Methodist Church, as a community of Jesus Christ in the Quad Cities, we've got the, we're in danger as well of just going through the motions, of putting so much attention into the structure, physically and committee-wise and otherwise, that we forget why we're here. And you know it. When I came here a year ago, you all said we need to be more of an outward-focused church. And so that's what we're trying to do. I'm really excited to say that we'll be working with Dr. Phil Maynard, a coach out of Florida. He's written several books. He'll come work with us because change is hard. And it's much better to have somebody from the outside who can come in and coach us and guide us and correct us and see the things that we can't see. That's what's ahead for us as a church. He'll be with us the week of June 15th. So mark that on your calendars, begin to prepare for that. Because we have the potential to also fall into that rut of just going through the motions, of building a big two-story house, and yet leaving something out. But God can also keep us on track. And we can help each other care for one another the way that God intended. So I want to, again, challenge you this week to invite Jesus to be a part of your relationship every day and with every other person that you're with. And here's, a thing I want to invite you to think about. How many, when you're done with a phone conversation, you talk to folks, what do you say when you're all done? Goodbye. Okay, you know where that comes from? In the 1500s, it was an abbreviation of God be with ye. So if you spell that, God be with you was the greeting. And over, you know, some 500 years, it's kind of God be with you, got abbreviated down to goodbye. Every time you say goodbye, you're saying God be with ye, and you didn't even know it. So here's your challenge. This week, every time you say bye to somebody, remind yourself, you're saying God be with ye. God be with you. Say it to yourself and say it to them. And invite Jesus be a part of your life, your relationship right now. And in that way, we'll try to build our house and yet not leave anything out. Not leave out the love of God and the love of our neighbors as we journey forth together. Let us pray. Gracious God, we praise you for your love, your goodness to us, and we offer ourselves now back to you. We pray that in the offerings that we make at this time, be one way in which we continue to give of ourselves for the sake of others. We thank you and praise you and pray that you would guide us now in Jesus' holy name.